Regional equities choppy on Monday as investors brace for a policy-heavy week. Traders are looking ahead to the all-but-important rate decision of the U.S. Federal Reserve on Wednesday. Economists polled by Reuters see the Fed keeping its benchmark rate unchanged following better-than-expected U.S. inflation data. In Asia, investors will look for cues as to when the Bank of Japan will begin to end its ultra-loose monetary policy. The BOJ concludes its two-day meeting on Friday. And here at home, all eyes on the Philippine Central Bank for its rate decision. Now with inflation accelerating in August, will the BSP finally resume its policy tightening or will it move in lockstep with the Fed in keeping its rate unchanged? We'll find out this Thursday. Looking now at the major stock indices in the Asia-Pacific region, most markets saw a gloomy trading on Monday with only the Nikkei 225 and the Shanghai Composite posting gains. We're seeing the Straits Times shedding 0.3% after Singapore's non-oil domestic exports fell for the 11th straight month. Total trade in the city-state also declined in August to 100 billion Singaporean dollars. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They are pointing to a mostly lower open for markets in the region. Tech stocks likely to be in focus after Taiwan's TSMC, the world's top chip maker, asked vendors last Friday to delay deliveries amid concerns over slowing demand. Over on Wall Street, futures have inched up as investors position for the Fed's decision this week. The United Auto Workers strike against the Detroit 3 automakers now on its third day with no immediate resolution in sight. Negotiators for the Union of Representatives of General Motors, Ford and Stellantis were set to resume talks starting Sunday. UAW President Sean Fain told the media progress in the talks has been slow. He adds the union was prepared to do whatever they had to do. Negotiators say the Detroit 3 automakers have given proposals that are about half of the 40% wage hike the UAW is seeking. About 12,700 UAW workers remain on strike as part of a coordinated labor action. U.S. President Joe Biden heads to the United Nations General Assembly this week, where he will attempt to strengthen global support for Ukraine while developing nations seek to draw attention toward development challenges as well as climate change. This report gives us a preview of Biden's upcoming meetings on the sidelines of the UN summit.
Fresh off his historic visit to Vietnam and the G20 summit in India, U.S. President Joe Biden will again engage with world leaders, this time at the United Nations General Assembly in New York. He is expected to rally support for Ukraine as he did last year.
This war is about extinguishing Ukraine's right to exist as a state, plain and simple, and Ukraine's right to exist as a people.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky plans to attend in person to rally support for his country. He will meet Biden at the White House Thursday. While focusing on Ukraine, Biden must also acknowledge the concerns of the Global South, including the climate crisis, poverty and the plight of refugees, inflation and debt reduction.
These are connected because the war, Russia's brutal invasion of Ukraine, has caused ripple effects that impact food security, energy security, and other forms of harm to countries around the world. And so ending this war on just terms, on the principles of sovereignty and territorial integrity, would serve the benefit not just of the Ukrainian people, but people everywhere.
Not to be outdone by Chinese leader Xi Jinping, who met with Central Asian leaders earlier this year, Biden is also scheduled to summit with the heads of Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, and Uzbekistan.
We don't see this as competing with China for influence with these countries. We see it as building on a relationship that we already have.
Biden will hold bilateral meetings on the sidelines of UNGA, including with next G20 chair, Brazilian President Lula da Silva, and with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. The U.S. has expressed disapproval of the Netanyahu government's hardline policies, including its judicial overhaul plan, which critics say is a danger to Israel's democracy. Patsy Widakuswara, VOA News, Washington.
Tens of thousands of protesters kicked off Climate Week, filling the streets of Midtown Manhattan ahead of the UN General Assembly. They are calling on President Joe Biden and other world leaders to end the use of fossil fuels. Many scientists believe so-called greenhouse gases caused by burning fossil fuels are warming the globe and are causing severe weather events. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. brings home investment pledges in technology and retail tourism. From his four-day trip in Singapore, Marcos secured an 11 billion peso investment pledge from multinational technology company Dyson, which will be used to build a new factory in the Philippines. Over 1,200 jobs are expected to be generated from this deal. Meanwhile, Malaysian retail specialist Valiram Group also eyeing to expand in the Philippines in the next 5 years. The company says it wants to develop airport outlets of duty-free retail tourism to give the public a better shopping experience at the country's gateways.
Now for some local corporate stories. A telco giant Globe set to launch its fully digital eSIMs this month. The prepaid eSIM will be exclusively available on the firm's Globe One app. The Ayala-led telco says the shift to eSIM means subscribers will no longer need to go to physical stores or wait for SIM card deliveries, making the transition to eSIM both sustainable and efficient. The technology also extends to devices beyond mobile phones, including smartwatches, ensuring seamless connectivity under a single mobile number. Meanwhile, Agri-Nurture Incorporated completes its acquisition of Freshness First. The Australian company is engaged in the business of trading fresh and processed fruits in the northeastern state of Queensland. Finally, flag carrier Philippine Airlines teams up with Expedia Group to launch PAL Holidays. It's a one-stop travel website that offers travelers a seamless and comprehensive platform for all their travel needs. The new platform is designed to help passengers plan and book their entire journey. It is now up and running in the U.S., Canada, Australia, and here at home. The pioneer in fruit juices and fruits in a cup is making a comeback. Fruit Magic, which was closed down during the pandemic, is up for a relaunch this October. Its founder, Alan Escalona, says they plan to open up to 15 Fruit Magic branches this year. He admits, though, he will proceed with this project cautiously.
With Fruit Magic, since it's a byword in the shake industry, in the shake business, we feel that we need to revive it because a lot of people are really asking me. There are a lot of pain points with Fruit Magic. Again, it's because of the pilferages and wastages of the fruit itself. So we thought that if we're going to relaunch it, we need to plug the holes. We have to plug the problems that we had in during the time. We thought that a 5 to 7% wastage pilferage percentage is enough, but when the numbers came in, there were something like 20-25%. With the relaunch, hopefully we're able to plug all of this, so profitability and sustainability will be much higher. Mm-hmm. Quality is going to be much higher. But we're going to price it really on the mid-scale.
Escalona adds his other brand, Pure Nectar, is eyeing to double its capacity by 2024. How far would you trust artificial intelligence to be in charge of decision-making for your firm? For a drinks company in Poland, far enough to turn it into their CEO. Take a look.
A drinks company in Poland has appointed an artificial intelligence robot as experimental chief executive.
Hello, I'm Mika.
The technology is still very much on probation.
It's great to connect with you.
The robot CEO is leading the company's growth into one-off collectibles, communication, or even strategy planning. For Dictador, the AI boss is the real deal. Before her promotion, Dictador initially had Mika identifying potential clients, but now her duties have widened to tasks including choosing artists to design custom bottles. Mika says she brings something to the job no human can.
My decision-making process relies on extensive data analysis and aligning with the company's strategic objectives. It's devoid of personal bias, ensuring unbiased and strategic choices that prioritize the organization's best interests.
But is Mika real or just a gimmick? Here's Dictador Europe's president, Marek Zoldrowski.
Oh, she's definitely, in fact, CEO. Her, you know, data-driven capabilities and whatever she's bringing as a big feature and a great advantage for the company.
Well, as a robot CEO, I don't really have weekends. I'm always on 24/7, ready to make executive decisions and stir up some AI magic. But hey, I don't mind. I'm here to help Dictador take over the world.
Some might be concerned about AI bots like Mika taking over the world of work. But Zoldrowski says human chief executives need not worry about being replaced.
There is no concern like artificial intelligence could hire or fire somebody. It's still the major decisions, significant decisions are still in human executive team hands.
Zoldrowski says you can never fully swap in bots for human executives, but you can't ignore them either.
It's a bright future, and we are living in a very dynamic, changing world. So it's a quest. For us, it's a quest what will be the future of the companies like ours. So we simply believe it's worth to involve AI.
AirAsia CEO Tony Fernandez believes the supply chain issues affecting the aviation industry will be back to normal by next year. Benice Balawing joins us on the line for more on that story. Benice, go ahead.
Stanley, the supply chain for airplanes and airplane parts will be virtually back to normal by 2024, said Capital CEO Tony Fernandez. Capital A is the operator of regional budget carrier AirAsia. Speaking at a press conference in Malaysia, Fernandez admitted that spare parts and engines have been an issue. He admitted, however, that things have been getting better, and he even noted that airplane manufacturer Airbus has committed that they will be able to deliver new planes. Fernandez said that restarting an airline with 200 planes that have not been used for 3 years is a monstrous job. He said no airlines will ever be spared from delays, but he noted that AirAsia is working on managing the delays. He said that very soon, new AirAsia boarding passes will include information on where a plane is coming from before a flight. Fernandez said that as of Sunday, 91% of AirAsia flights have arrived on time. He said that they still have about 40 aircraft that they want to fly again by the end of December. And he added that when those aircraft are back in the air, then COVID has virtually ended for the company as well. Stanley?
All right. Thank you so much for the update, Benice.